Hallo, hallo. Hallo, yes. Okay, let's start. This is already my fourth lecture. In the first lectures, two lectures, I did nothing else than solving the equation of motion for a particle in a model potential. Yesterday, I showed you how you can use the solutions of the Schrödinger equation for calculating properties. And I showed you how to calculate the scattering amplitude. We discussed that the scattering amplitude is an essential complex quantity. And we used it to calculate the cross-section. Then I used the expressions that we derived for the phase shift to give special expressions for the cross-section for specific cases. For instance, in the case of a narrow resonance. In all cases, I focused in particular and on the resonances near threshold because those are the ones that are very important for our field because those are the ones that turn out to make it possible to vary the interactions between particles. With the potentials I introduced so far, the potential was given by nature to us. You have a potential well of a certain type, let's say a van der Waals potential, and it has a certain range, and that's what we have to deal with. It gives rise to a certain scattering length, certain phase shift, depending on energy a little bit, but that's what we have to deal with. But what we did all the time was a nice exercise. We did as if it was possible to vary the well depth. We studied the scattering length as a function of the well depth. But in general, your system is not such that you can simply vary the well depth. Normally, your well depth is defined by the Coulomb potential and the particles involved in your system. But you already saw that as a function of the well depth, we could have these beautiful resonances. And of course, the question comes, is there a way in which we can use those resonances to our advantage? Because if we could tune those resonances, we would be able to change the scattering length, that means change the energetic and kinetic properties of our system. And the answer is, otherwise I wouldn't be here, yes, there is such a method. And the method is called the Feshbach resonance. But in order to understand the Feshbach resonance, we have to deal with real atoms. So far, I was studying particles and model well potential, and I didn't discuss any internal structure of the particles. But as soon as we have a real atom, then you switch on all the interactions that become available due to the fact that there is internal structure. There is a nucleus. There are electrons in the atom. So it is good that we started very relaxed with analyzing all those simple cases of simple model potentials, because as soon as we put structure into the atom, the problem becomes much more complicated. And so what I'm, and it's important not to, to lose track due to the complications. So what I will do, I will start to put internal structure in the atom and then show you how you can still map it on the simple picture, on the simple model potentials that I showed you. I only work with these model potentials. But you can you can replace the word model by the actual potential, the real potential of your system. It only means that it becomes more complicated to do the same calculation. And for us it was simple because we had analytic solutions and we could analyze the analytic solutions. We are allowed to do that because close to the threshold, close to the threshold, the scattering behavior becomes universal. We saw this with the appearance of scattering length. We saw this with the periodic divergences of the scattering length. The behavior becomes becomes universal. Okay, so it is our task to put internal structure and see how we can deal with this. And as you will see, I will do it in two steps. I will introduce the atomic structure, and that is typically what you all know, at least have had in detail, that is the structure of the atom, of the individual atom in the presence of hyperfine structure. I won't discuss the case of fine structure because I will be dealing with system where there's no electronic orbital angular momentum. It simplifies matters a lot. Yes. But it's not really essential, and it holds for many cases of real systems that are being studied. Okay, let me switch this on. Does it work? Yes, it works if we stick this in. Okay, so how did we start? We started with the Schrödinger equation, yes? Then, thus far, this was a fixed potential. What happens if we put internal structure? Something will happen to our potential. Before we do that, we recapitulate, because we are going to repeat the same procedure as we had without the internal structure. So what we did, we took our operators, L squared and LZ, and we used the separation of variables between the rotational levels and the radial motion of the two atoms. We used two atoms, but we threw out the center of mass motion. We are only looking at the relative motion of the particles. We have separation of variables between the radial wave function and the angular wave function. And for LA0, S waves, we know that the YLM is simply a constant, 1 over 4 pi, square root of 4 pi. So then we let the operators act, and then we got the radial wave equation in which we recognized, for a given L, a rotational barrier. Okay, so that's the story. This story is all you need if you want to discuss atoms without spin. For instance, helium-4. Yeah? You take helium-4, the nuclear spin is zero, the atomic spin is zero. This is helium-4. The first lectures were for helium-4. Now I'm going to look at the case of alkali atoms. What happens if we start to look at alkali atoms? Well, if we have two alkali atoms, it means that we have two nuclei and two electrons that play a role in the bonding, just as in the case of hydrogen. There are, of course, core electrons, but the core electrons don't play a role in the bonding. So we have to put two electrons in the Coulomb field of those two nuclei. And there's two ways in which we can do. We can have two ways in which we can do this, because we have a total electronic spin, which is given by the spin of the individual electrons. And if you have an electron with spin 1/2, your total spin can be unity or it can be zero. If S is zero, then you can say the spins are paired and the electrons probe the electrostatic field of both nuclei very strongly. They're in between. On the other hand, so let me see. So this is the state, because they probe the field on both sides, this is the state that gives the strongest binding. So if you look at the ground state of the molecule, its electronic ground state, these are singlet states for all the alkalis and also for hydrogen. I don't look in the molecule at electronic angular momentum, what you would call L in the atom. I take it to be zero, and that's what you have with the ground state orbitals of molecules. Okay, so associated with this S is zero state, it's called the singlet, is a potential which is called the singlet potential. And this potential, the well of this potential, the depth is determined by the Coulomb interaction. But at large distances, the van der Waals interaction takes over. So this interaction, where you have an effective spin-dependent interaction, is known the exchange interaction. And so it looks like a spin-dependent interaction, but you're looking at the electrostatic interaction. It's a combination of the spin state in combination with the electrostatic interaction. So, and this exchange interaction falls off exponentially if you go to large distance. So at large distances, the van der Waals interaction takes over, which is determined by the polarizability, mutual polarizability of the atoms. So this is a short-range potential. Certainly if we look at S waves. So we can define our R0, which is the range of the interaction. The chemists call the ground state of these alkalis the X state, which is the singlet sigma G plus level. Yeah? So, but we take a more compact notation. First I have to show you the triplet. When you have the spins in parallel, you know two fermions cannot be at the same place. They are separated in space. That means they mostly probe one of the nuclei, and the interaction is more weak. And that's why the triplet potential, red curve here, is less deep. And the lowest triplet potential, there's always excited states, of course, is called the A state. And it's called the triplet singer U plus potential. Okay, the U and the plus are symmetries that I'm not going to enter into this, because I'm keeping it as simple as possible. And I emphasize the essential point that whatever the two alkalis, you cannot have more than two potentials. It's either a singlet or triplet potential. So we move from the situation where we only had one potential to the situation where we have two potentials. So then the potential I will denote by V sub S, where S is the value of S. It can be zero or one. Yes. If it's one, it is the triplet potential, because for S is one, you have three M sub S possible values. And I denote it by V sub 1. Yeah. And if this is called, I call this the triplet potential. And if S is zero, we're dealing with the singlet potential, and I denote it by V0. Okay. So rather than giving the chemical notation or the symmetry notation, I simply write V0 or V1. Okay. Conclusion. Exchange dominates the interaction between two atoms at short distance. At long distance, we have the van der Waals interaction. And because the exchange falls off exponentially, we have a range, because the van der Waals interaction has a range. Okay. So we have to expand our Hilbert space, because so far we had the relative motion of the particles. That means we had the angular motion and we had the radial motion, but now we also have to introduce the spin. So we introduce the electron spin with the S and M sub S values, the quantum numbers of the spin. Here I have L and M sub L, by which I give the rotational motion, but I focus on S waves for the relative motion, so this will be zero. And this is the electronic degree of freedom. But that degree of freedom, we work with a state in which there's no electronic angular momentum, orbital angular momentum. So this state, in fact, drops completely out of the analysis. And I won't pull it back at this point. Okay. So to represent, so we now need an expression for our potential. And to get this expression, we construct a spin Hamiltonian. We write our Hamiltonian as the sum of a direct term and an exchange term. J is called the exchange constant. So the direct term is written as a linear combination of the singlet and triplet potential. And this is just a construct that I make. In nature, we find the singlet and triplet potentials, and we can define a direct interaction which does not depend on the spin, which is 1/4 V0 plus 3/4 V1. So, and this is the exchange. The exchange is a difference in energy, difference in Coulomb energy, depending on whether you're in the singlet or triplet state. And it's nothing else than the difference between the triplet potential and the singlet potential, V1 minus V0. So now I claim that this, that we can work with this potential, and that serves us for very well for the following reason. If we take this operator, this is of course an operator in quantum mechanics, and let it work on the singlet state, S is zero, M sub S is zero, it only produces the singlet potential. And if and so S dot 1, S dot 2, you can write as the inner product representation can be written as 1/2 S squared minus S1 squared minus S2 squared. If we take the same operator acting on the state 1, S is 1, M sub S can be 1, 0, or minus 1, in all cases we obtain the triplet potential. Yes. Who knows what the name is of such an operator? Operator with this property. It's called a projection operator. So let's see that it works, just as a small exercise, for the fun of it. So let's take the upper line. We have to show that nu, the potential, let's say V, potential working on the 0,0 state equals V0 of R times the 0,0 state. Well, this contains of two parts. It's the direct. Let's first take the direct term. The direct term, if I take V direct, acting on the zero-zero state. Well, it's spin independent, so it's very simple. It gives us 1/4 times V naught plus 3/4 V1.
Yes.
So now I take the second part, which is J times S1 dot S2. Yeah, working on this. And this is J times 1/2 S squared minus S1 squared minus S2 squared, working on the zero, zero state. And now you're going to help me. 1/2 J times. What does the big S give on this state? Zero. What does S, small S1 give on that state? What?
Plus or minus 1/2.
Plus or minus 1/2. Plus or minus 1/2. Are there other options? Yes. What is the spin of an electron? 1/2. So S1 is 1/2. And if you let S1 operate, you get S1, times S plus 1. Yes? Yeah, S1 plus 1. So what you get is 1/2 times 3/2 is 3/2 is 3/4. Yes? And you get twice the same, because these electrons are the same. So you get minus 3/2. We have here 1/2. It gives us V triplet minus V singlet times 3/4 with a minus sign, yes? Minus sign. So now let's see. If we add these two, we get minus V1. Where is this? Minus, I get here minus minus 3/4 for V0, yes? And here that is plus 1/4 V0. So if I add these, I get in total, and here you have 1/4, so you get V0. Indeed, you get out, if you add those two, you get out, in this case, if I let this work, I get out exactly this one, yes? V0. And the other one drops out because, what is it? I have here minus V1 3/4 V1, and here plus 3/4 V1, and the two drop out. Okay, so it works. And you can do it with the triplet in the same way. And if you're lazy, you write your projection operator as like this. But is it zero? Yes. Plus, what is it? The one M V1, 1 M, like this. Then you project out either the singlet or the triplet part. Yes, so this works. We use the projection operator, and that's nice, because we wrote our Hamiltonian in this form with the potential. And if we use for our potential this form, the potential we obtain depends on the state on which we have the operator act. So if we act it on an eigenstate, which is a singlet, we get the singlet potential. If we act it on the eigenstate, which is the triplet, we obtain the triplet potential. Very convenient. The formula at least stays the same. And I have to distinguish between singlet and triplet cases, and those are the only two cases you have to consider, because these are alkalis. Questions on this? Okay. Let's continue. So now we have two atoms, and we have the exchange interaction in the system, and now we have we are going to look more at the atom by applying a magnetic field. If we apply a magnetic field on the atom, we obtain a Zeeman effect. Yeah? And the Zeeman Hamiltonian is given by S1 dot B and S2 dot B, and it's multiplied by the geomagnetic ratio of the electrons. Electrons have the same spin, so depending on whether the spins are parallel or anti-parallel, we have the total S. S1 plus S2 is big S, so we can write our Hamiltonian in this very convenient, simple form. Yes? And if we take our quantization axis along the B field, then we get it that the Zeeman term goes with the Z operator and proportional to B. And the geomagnetic ratio is the G value of the electron mu B over H bar. Okay. So if we calculate then the shift, we find that the shift, the Zeeman shift, is proportional to the B field and proportional to the magnetic quantum number M sub S. Now what we say, big M sub S is a good quantum number. What do we mean by that? It's a good quantum number. It means that the Hamiltonian S we have is diagonal for that quantum number. Yeah? So it's conserved in time. So I already showed you the inner product rule that is listed here. But there's another inner product rule in which we write the express the S1 dot S2 in the SZ operators and the raising and lowering operators. Yes? And from this expression, you immediately see that big S, big M sub S, is a good quantum number. Because the SZ operators do not affect the projection, and S1 will raise M sub S1 by 1, but S2 minus will lower M sub S2 by 1. So it means that the big M sub S is conserved. M sub S is a good quantum number. So our Hamiltonian, including the Zeeman term, is now this. Yeah? Here, you know, this is the exchange interaction now. And here you have the Zeeman contribution. And in order to describe this, we have the quantum numbers that are relevant are given by a state which is defined by a radial part, which depends on S and L. And in fact, it also should depend on V. That's a typo. And it depends on whether we have what type of end over end rotation we have for our molecule. And it depends on S and M sub S. And it's diagonal in this representation. It is diagonal in the singlet triplet representation because this is the big S M sub S. So this can be a singlet state or a triplet state. And if we have this operator act on this state, it selects either the triplet or the singlet. Yeah? So in this basis, everything works well. Questions? Okay. So I've copied it here, and I'm going to continue. So coming back to the procedures of the previous lectures, what our task will be is to solve the radial wave equation for given values of L, S, and M sub S. Yeah? That means our radial wave equation looks the way we have seen it now many times, with the second derivative, the first derivative with T over R, etc., the energy, and an effective potential. And it used to be that our effective potential consisted of the van der Waals potential plus a rotational barrier. So our effective potential was L dependent. In this case, it depends on whether we have our Hamiltonian act on a singlet or a triplet state, whether this is the singlet or triplet potential. And on top of that, we have a contribution of the same energy. Those are the, this is the potential. And you see, we will see what it does. It depends on B. Yeah? And this term is independent of R. Yes. So what happens if your magnetic field increases? It simply shifts the potential. And the way it shifts depends on M sub S. So now look at our triplet potential. If we increase the magnetic field, we can shift it, and the degeneracy is lifted depending on the value of M. So now what we have is not two potentials, but we have four potentials. Yeah? And the potential we're dealing with now depends on S and M sub S. If we have S is zero, we have the singlet potential, the blue curve. If we have S is one, we have a triplet potential. But it can be that we're dealing with the M sub S is one, zero, or minus one state. And you see that, of course, that the M sub S is zero state doesn't shift. Because if this is zero, this term is zero. Yes? So it's still very manageable. Yes? Okay. Now we go to the Feshbach resonance. Let's have a look. The problem of a Feshbach resonance is the following. If you have this internal structure of the atoms, and you bring two atoms close together, there's all these states that you can have, these internal states. And depending on all these internal states, you can have potentials. And as you know, there's many hyperfine levels. And for every hyperfine level, you will find a different potential. It is quite a business. So it's highly specialized business. But we'll pick out only the essential part. Let's see. What I've done here is I've drawn two potentials, a blue one and a red one. So the blue one is the singlet, and the red one is the triplet. Red ones we can shift. Yeah. And in these potentials, of course, we can have bound states. Yeah. We will have a least bound level in the open potential, and that's how we started. Yeah. We started with calculating the scattering, the phase shift, if we had a simple potential with a bound state or with a virtual bound state. Here we have a bound state in this channel, the red channel. And then there's another potential. That's the blue channel, and it also has bound state. It has many bound states. Often there are many, many bound states. Yes? Vibrational levels, rotational levels, many bound states. But these are eigenstates of either of the corresponding potential. Yeah. So it means that unless there is some type of interaction that we didn't write down, at the level of the analysis, the Hamiltonian we have so far, the eigenstates of the red potential are completely orthogonal to the eigenstates of the blue potentials. And we have many blue potentials. And but it's all orthogonal. So the fact with the Hamiltonian that we have, it means that if we don't couple to it. If they're orthogonal, we don't couple to it. And these states exist independently. Okay. Now what we can do, If we increase the energy, we can raise the energy from the threshold. That's the low energy threshold. That's the zero energy limit. We can raise the energy, and we denote it by k squared, as we did before, to a level where our energy in the continuum is resonant to the energy of bound state, of one bound state, pick one in one of the blue potentials. Well, then you have a so-called resonant situation, and you know that if you have a resonant situation, all that you need is a weak coupling to already produce a possibility to go from the continuum state to the bound state. This, in general, this is a problem of a bound state embedded in a continuum. That's the Feshbach problem. And this is how it's studied, how the Feshbach resonances were studied in nuclear physics. Because in nuclear physics, the potentials are fixed. So the only thing that you can vary is the collision energy in order to find the resonance. But our field is special. Because what we can do is we can shift the potentials, the singlet potentials, with respect to the triplet potentials. So there's another way in which we can meet the resonance condition. And that other way is that we can tune, as we say it, a Feshbach we can tune to a Feshbach resonance by applying a magnetic field. It's called Zeeman tuning. And in the cartoon it goes like this. We shift the field until the point that our continuum state, it's close to the threshold, can be even k equals zero if you like, meets the energy of the bound state. You see, the bound state doesn't shift in this simple picture. It's because it's a pure singlet. There are more complicated situations. But we look at the principle. So this is called Feshbach tuning of the resonance. So as soon as our continuum state is resonant with the bound state, all we need is a weak interaction to couple from the continuum to the bound state. So now I have to introduce some nomenclature that you will find in the literature. Let's do it. If we take the red curve, we can look at the red curve as the potential as we have been playing with in the first lectures. It is just a potential well. And you can go in with S wave, you go out with S waves, and it's called the open channel. You go in, you go out, it's open. And the zero of energy with respect to the asymptote of the potential energy at large distance is zero, is called the threshold energy. And I've already used that term many times. It's the threshold. So then we have a finite energy in the continuum, if we scatter, a finite energy with respect to the threshold. It's k squared. Yes. Then there is a singlet potential. Okay? We call it the closed channel. Why? You see that if you would be able to leak through to a level here, you would never have enough energy. This is the energy level. This is the energies that you bring. You will never be able to escape along the other potential. So that means if you cross to one of the bound states, the only way in which you can go out is through the way you came in. And there's an impedance. There's a weak coupling between the open channel and the closed channel if you're resonant. And there's a resonant coupling. Okay. This energy, we call it minus kappa squared in our simple model. Yeah. This blue curve is called a closed channel. It's a molecular state, it's closed channel, we cannot escape it, we're going to go in, and then, in fact, we can go out, but only in a resonant way. So you come in, you couple, you oscillate many times in the bound state, and after some time you go out again. That's the picture, classical picture. This is a closed channel plotted in the situation below threshold, because this bound state is below the threshold. In the model potentials that I showed you, it corresponds to this plot. This is the square well potential with the delta function at the barrier, at the edge, the range. So you see, we come in with the continuum state with the delta function. We can tune the coupling to the bound states, and the bound states are the states behind the barrier. If this delta function is infinitely strong, there's no coupling, and we simply have a ladder of bound states, as you have bound states in molecular potentials. So this is the problem we can solve. So in so-called single channel model for a Feshbach resonance, you use this picture. And we have analyzed the phase shift in the presence of that barrier, and we derived the value for R star as a measure for the width of the resonance phenomenon. Okay. So this is a closed channel with the level below threshold, the molecular level below threshold. It is below threshold, so we have a weakly bound state. And because all these resonances are universal, close to the threshold, we know that the scattering length is positive, at least as long as the potentials are sufficiently deep. Potential, very deep potential. So we know that in this case, we have a positive scattering length. Now let's look at a closed channel above threshold. A closed channel corresponds to the blue curve with the bound state. And now you have a so-called quasi-bound state in the continuum, because it's quasi-bound, because if there's a weak coupling, you will go in the continuum at fairly high energies. Yes? So this is a state. If you are in this state, you can decay from that state. It is called predissociation. If you have a state which is quasi-bound, long-lived, and you are above the threshold, it's called predissociation, because it's there before it dissociates. Predissociation. Okay, how did it look in our cartoons? In our cartoons, we moved the potential up, we made the potential less deep. It means that this level shifts up from the weakly bound state into the continuum, where it becomes quasi-bound. In that case, we have a negative scattering length. So these two cases we can solve schematically. Of course, if you want to do this with real potentials, it becomes much more complicated. But I'm not doing that, because then it's easy to lose track on the essential physics. Okay, so what is our task? We know now that we have these open, yes? Yeah. So you say you cannot reach this.
Yeah.
Yeah. But that's what I showed you. If we are below the threshold, if we are below the threshold, there is a relation between the scattering length and the energy of the bound state. Close to the threshold, it's universal. Recall, A was equal to 1 over kappa. Yeah. So that means that also if you are bound, admittedly only weakly bound, in the continuum, you already feel it. So you can go there. But then, of course, you're never resonant to the actual level, but you're above. That means you're not really resonant. That means that your resonant enhancement, when you go through the barrier, is small, and you go out rapidly again. That's it. Yes? Okay. Other questions? Then let's continue. So now our task is to find the coupling. We should find the term in the Hamiltonian that gives rise to the coupling. And we are going to add terms in the Hamiltonian until we find the coupling. So this is our Hamiltonian. You know, we have the part for the relative motion. We have here the Zeeman term. These are the states. And we have to solve the radial wave equation with this form for the potential. So now we find, if we do the exercise, we find the solutions. And now the world separates in experimentalists and theoreticians. The theoretician says the following. What I have to do is I take my Hamiltonian and I have to sandwich it between the states and I have to calculate what the energies are. Well, this person, this theoretician, is in for a difficult job because he has to know the potential very accurately, he has to solve the Schrödinger equation, and as I said in the first lecture, if you have a potential of many electron volts deep, and you have to study for positions at the level of a few microkelvin, it's simply impossible to do this numerically. So this is one of the situations, and it happens more often, that you prefer to be an experimentalist. So, because what can you say as an experimentalist? You can say, whatever the wave function may be, after your calculation of 10 years, yes, in the end, you get out the energy. And if I can measure the energy, that can also take 10 years, of course, but if you measure the energy, you've got all you need. So we have to look at solutions. And then we know that the energy in the continuum will be given by the collisional energy, which I know, and there is a Zeeman contribution, which depends on the magnetic field. This part is simple. But in the bound states, yeah, the bound states, you have bound states which depend on the total spin, you know, and on the vibrational quantum number and the L quantum number, rotational quantum number. This is just the matrix element for the bound state. The bound states. You have various bound states, so I have a vibrational quantum number, and it depends on S and it depends on L. Those are the energies of the bound state. And these energies here, for the bound state, do not depend on the Zeeman energy. So I can forget about this part of my state. The second one, this gives me the dependence on L. It's the rotational barrier. So I have to take the same radial wave functions, if you like, and you have to sandwich the 1 over r squared potential between those states, and it gives you L times L plus 1 times a constant that you can measure by varying L. Okay. So those terms are there, and in the end you get here a number. And this we can all calculate. Okay, so maybe other questions? So now we know that, at least in principle, if we go through the steps of solving the radial wave equation, we get our continuum states and our bound states. Okay, let's continue. So, this is my Hamiltonian in the presence of a Zeeman interaction. The next term in our Hamiltonian is to introduce the nucleus. I'm not considering the spin-orbit coupling between because I'm working with alkali atoms in the ground state. There's no spin-orbit coupling, and also in the molecule there's no spin-orbit coupling. So I go directly to the nucleus. And then, of course, there's a nuclear Zeeman effect. Yeah? If I have two unlike atoms, then I have two gyromagnetic ratios, two nuclear spins, and the Zeeman shift of energies is given simply by proportional to the B field and proportional to the magnetic quantum numbers of the nuclei 1 and the nucleus 2. So I have to add this term in my Hamiltonian. Because again, I take my quantization axis along the B field, and then I only have to use the S sub Z to the I sub Z to calculate the energy. So it means, because I've added the nuclear spins, I have to extend my Hilbert space. So I introduce a nuclear spin dependent part for nucleus 1 and nucleus 2. So now I get an effective potential. My Hamiltonian still looks the same, but I get now an effective potential that became a bit more complicated. Yes. Apart from the exchange part and the rotational barrier and the electron Zeeman energy, I now have a nuclear Zeeman energy contribution. And you know, those nuclear shifts are much smaller than the electronic Zeeman shift. So it doesn't change much in the potential. But of course, we must ask, if you have unlike atoms, it can also be that you have identical atoms, and that's determined, of course, by the nuclear spin. So we can do the same exercise if you have identical atoms, and what you then can construct is a total nuclear spin, and you get and you can define a total M sub I, which is simply M1 plus M2. And in that case, the Zeeman term, the sum of the two nuclear spin contributions, nuclear Zeeman contributions, can be written as minus gamma nuclear. Those are, in this case, the same, the gyromagnetic ratios, times the big I, which is the sum of the two small I. So in that case, I have here a term that depends on big I sub Z. And in that case, I can write my basis state. In that case, I'm dealing with identical particles. You recall yesterday we showed that if you have identical particles in the scattering, you lose half of the possibilities, and you pick up a factor of two in the amplitudes. And that's here also. I will look in particular at the case of identical particles, because I will have the half of the number of states available. And that simplifies matter, because if you have many levels, it's difficult to keep track. Yeah. Okay, so now in that case, I have an effective potential where I have all these terms, and now I have a total, I have a nuclear Zeeman term corresponding to the total M sub I, magnetic quantum number of the total nuclear spin. Okay. So now I have to look at the interaction between two hydrogen atoms, and I'm first going to look at the unlike atoms. And then you know if you have S and I, you get a quantum number F. It's the hyperfine angular momentum state. In the case L is zero, of course. And now the question is M sub F still a good quantum number? And my question to you is M sub F a good quantum number? How do we analyze that? M sub I is M1 plus M2. M sub S is MS1 plus MS2. answer is yes, it is a good quantum number. Why? Because if I write I dot s, no matter it's one or two, yeah, then I can write it, this inner product, in the form where I have two z operators here, and I have a raising operator for the nucleus and a lowering operator for the electron. Yeah. So that means that if I have this interaction, these two interactions, if I raise ms1, then I lower m1, and vice versa. So that means the total m sub f is a good quantum. And that's important because there will be many, many potentials, but we only have to look at those that have a that have the same value of m sub f, both in the continuum and in the bound state, because it's a conserved quantity. Okay. Then the question is S still a good quantum number? And that is a very important question, because if S is not a good quantum number, I have coupling between the singlet and triplet potentials, and that's exactly the coupling I'm looking for. If I have this coupling, then apparently there's a link between the singlet potentials and the triplet potentials, and that's exactly the coupling that I need, the link that I need to cross from the continuum states to the bound state, to observe the Feshbach resonance. So, question is this a good quantum number? Well, to answer that question, it is nice to realize that you can split up this expression for the hyperfine Hamiltonian, or hyperfine interaction, into two contributions. One contribution is called H hyperfine plus, and the other contribution is H hyperfine minus. How are they defined? They're defined as a given here, and you just have to accept it. And it's a simple exercise to verify that indeed, if you add these two, it gives the proper answer. So if I have the plus here, I use the plus here, I use the plus here, and I use the plus there. If the minus sign here, I use the minus sign here, etc. So this is my expression for the plus and minus hyperfine interaction. Now, I look at the H hyperfine plus. If you have identical atoms, let's just like for simplicity the case of identical atoms, then I1 is equal to I2. We can add the two and we get the big nuclear spin, and we get a term that looks like I dot S. Yeah? And if you have this interaction, it can change m sub s, but not s and m sub f. Yeah? So that means this operator acts within the manifold of the electronic spin state. That means it mixes the triplet states, and the singlet state is not degenerate. So it only mixes triplet state. And if you look at the inner products, you can write the inner products like this, as we saw before. We find that in this Hamiltonian, S remains a good quantum number. So the HF plus, the hyperfine plus, is a Hamiltonian that conserves singlet and triplet character. So it is a good quantum number, and that means we still didn't find the coupling between the singlet and triplet potentials. Now, in the lecture notes, you will find the proof for the following case. It takes a bit more space, but it goes quite in analogously. If you take the HF minus, then you find that it converts singlet potential in triplet potential, or the other way around. So that means you have these two terms. One conserves S, and the other one changes singlet and triplet, or vice versa. But they have a very different behavior. And that means that this HF plus term does not conserve the S, that means it couples the singlet potential to the triplet potential. So it is this term that gives rise to the Zeeman coupling, to the Feshbach coupling. So we found our term. It's the HF minus. So we'll have to look at it. So we look at the interaction between two atoms, two alkali atoms. I write again my Hamiltonian, Zeeman term, nuclear term, and we have the HF plus and the HF minus. All terms conserve M sub F. The only term that is non-singlet triplet conserving is the HF minus. So now, if we look at our basis states, if we have unlike particles or if we have identical particles, we have to deal with those two bases, and this is the effective potential in both cases. But this is the situation. That this is the level where we can stop our Hamiltonian. This is enough to find Feshbach resonances. And you can already see that the strength of the Feshbach resonance will depend on the strength of this hyperfine interaction, because that's the term that is responsible for the coupling. Now, I give an example, and the example is with two lithium atoms, two atoms of lithium 6. Then I have to specify the atoms. Let's have a look, the atoms. Lithium 6, I have here the triplet potential of lithium 6. I have two lithium atoms, let's say, spin polarized. Yes. So then the total spin is 1, because it's a triplet potential, and it means it's threefold degenerate. L is 0. I have no end over end rotation. I only look at S wave collisions. And then I have a least bound level, and this least bound level is a level where S is 1 and L is 0. That's what it's given here. And here you have the vibrational quantum number, and it's V equals minus 1, which is it's the vibrational level if you start counting from the threshold. So it's the least bound level. And in order not to write all this, I simply write epsilon 1. That's the least bound level in the triplet potential. Then I also have a singlet potential. Singlet potential is S is 0 by definition. It's non-degenerate. L is 1. L is 0 again. I'm only interested in L is 0 because the angular momentum is a conserved quantity in our Hamiltonian. And now, of course, I also have a bound state. And this is a 0-0 state because S is 0 here. And the least bound level is given by epsilon naught. That's the notation. Now, I'm going to look at the hyperfine structure. So if I add the nuclear spin of lithium 6, then I can look up the nuclear spin is equal to 1. And if the nuclear spin is equal to 1 and the electronic spin is 1/2, we can have a total angular momentum, which is the sum or the difference for a spin 1/2 system. So it can be 3/2 or 1/2. F is 1/2 or 3/2. Those are the two options that we have. Now my question to you is lithium 6, because I'm going to use two lithium atoms. Yes, I have two lithium atoms. So those are identical atoms. So we need now to know, in this audience, we have to decide whether these are bosons or fermions. So my question to you is, are these bosons or fermions? Who dares?
Each one of them are fermions, but...
Each one of them?
Yeah.
They're the same. Yeah, pick one, and then is the fermion or is the boson? Please speak out. Who? Or maybe if we cannot decide scientifically, maybe we should have a vote. Yes. Who votes boson? I see one boson, one brave boson. Who votes fermion? There's more fermions. But there's a lot of people that didn't go to the voting booth. You see how dangerous it is to decide something by a vote. So now, so there we are. So how do we decide now? Of course, we can take the democratic decision and continue. But maybe it may be a nice exercise to find out whether it is a boson or a fermion. What discriminates bosons for fermions, if you want to keep it as simple? You've all learned this. What?
Half
integral spin. So we have to sort out whether this system has a half integral spin or has an integral spin. And what does it have? 1/2 or 3/2, half integral spin. Of course, it's a fermion, half integral spin. Everybody knows this. Let's face it. There's another way in which you can look at this, and it's very nice, and it's it shows something extremely deep. So if you have an atom, you have a cloud of electrons, and you have a nucleus. Yeah? How many electrons do you have in lithium?
Three
electrons. How many protons do you have in lithium? Yeah, tell me. Three, yes, of course, because the atom is neutral, yes? So it has to be three. Three protons. How many neutrons do you have in lithium?
Five.
Yes, why? Because the mass is 8 or so. But it's lithium 6. Yeah? Yes, so you have three neutrons. Three neutrons. What is the spin of a proton? 1/2. What is the spin of an electron? 1/2. What is the spin of the neutron? Yes? Loud? 1/2, yes. Okay. So if I add two spin 1/2, I can only make interspin 0 or 1. So if I have three electrons, and so if I add the third electron, it becomes odd again. So if I have six electrons, I can only add it up to an integer total spin. If I use the triangular inequality for adding angular momenta. So these two give me always an integer spin. So I'm left here with three neutrons, which all have spin 1/2. And it means that if you have three spin 1/2, you can only make half integral angular momentum. Yes? But isn't that amazing? Because if you somewhere deep in the atom, in the nucleus, stick one extra neutron, you get lithium 7, and it's a boson. Chemically, the system is totally different. The mass, okay, the mass is slightly different, but there's not much changing. But in the collisional phenomena, it is fabulous. You change from having only even collisions, cross-section in which you have to sum over the even angular momenta, and in the other case, you have to sum only over the odd equal angular momenta. By something deep inside of the atom, it's something very deep. Okay. I know one thing for sure. If you leave this school, you will be capable of deciding an element, whether it's a boson or a fermion. Yes. Okay, let's continue. I have to say whether I have a coupling constant which is positive or negative for the nuclear spin, and then I can draw the hyperfine structure. This is what we all have done many times. Yes. So let's have a look. Let's have a look, because we're going to do this for the molecule, and then it will be more difficult. So I don't want to lose you on this point. So let's do it. Plot is already there. B, this is the Zeeman energy. F is 1/2 or 3/2. You know that if you have two alkalis, that the state with the highest multiplicity always has a positive G factor. I have a positive geomagnetic ratio, so the shift, the state with the highest multiplicity shifts to the top. So here I have my F equals 3/2. Here I have my F equals 1/2. So this splits up in 2, this has to split up in 4. This is a pure state, it means it's not coupled to any of the other spin states. It's a straight line. Then this goes up. This goes up, this goes down, and this goes down. G is positive, G is negative for all alkali pairs. That means here I know that if this is 3/2, that means that M sub F is 3/2, 1/2, minus 1/2, minus 3/2. Here I find minus 1/2, here I find plus 1/2, because here the G is negative, so this is minus 1/2 and this is plus 1/2. This is electron spin up, this is electron spin down, and what is the difference between these three? Why I have here three? You know it, but say it. Because of the Zeeman shift of the nucleus, yes? But if that is the case, why then, if you add a nuclear spin, if you add a nuclear spin, here the nuclear spin increases if you go up, and here it goes down. So here the level counting is not the same as in this coverage. And I give you the answer. Because in a very high field, that's the case. The nuclear spins, depending on the spin, you always shift up, whether the electron spin is up or down. You always shift up in one direction. But the answer is that this plot typically stops if you work with alkalis at a field of 2,000 Gauss or so, a few thousand Gauss. At least at a field much less than 1 Tesla. And if you go to 16 Tesla, then these three levels intersect at one point, and then they go up at the other side. Did you know that those levels intersect? You've seen this plot many times, isn't it? And you did not know that they intersect, but I tell you that they intersect. And so all three intersect at the same point. It is the point where the Zeeman shift exactly cancels the zero field splitting. Okay, just to know. Okay, so now we have to construct. We see that the basic physics is very simple. We have an electron with a very strong magnetic moment, and we have a nucleus with a very weak magnetic moment. So it means that the plot is dominated by the magnetic moment of the electron. Electron spin up, electron spin down. The weak moment of the nucleus gives rise to a small splitting here or a small splitting there. Only in low field, where you have coupling between electron spin and the nuclear spin, it is this coupling that gives rise to something that becomes, again, appreciable. And this coupling gives rise to the splitting. And if the hyperfine coupling constant is A, how big is the splitting? Now I address myself to the experimentalist. It is 3/2 A. You might say that this is just the coupling constant. It is not the coupling constant. The coupling constant times the multiplicity of the highest level. But this is what you learn in your atomic physics course. And you see that I've given the atomic physics course before. Okay, so this is the atom. We refreshed ourselves. We know now how to do this with the atom. Now we are going to do the same thing with the molecule. Because what is now the what is the hyperfine structure of the molecule? Or better, we will see. We will see. Let's have a look. Did I forget? Yeah, so that's this 3/2 A. Yes, now I put, because I want to do Fischbach resonances, I'm going to put atoms. One here at the state -1/2 and one there at the state +1/2. So that means the big M sub F is the sum of the two is zero. So we have to, if we are looking at S waves, we are looking, we start out with two atoms with L is zero and also a state where M sub F is zero. So we have to look which states we can produce with M sub F is zero. Okay, so from the free atom pair, that's the open channel, we have to go to a molecule to the closed channel under conservation of the quantum numbers that we have. So we have to find all S-wave molecules with M sub F is zero. That's our task. Okay, let's first look at S is zero. S is zero state. How does the Zeeman diagram look? Straight line. Okay, now there's, yeah, so the case, it's a straight line. But I first should tell you something else, I guess, if I listen to the person who made this sheet, yeah? And I have to find a way of identifying the molecules which have these properties. And that's also a nice exercise, to look at the symmetry of the molecule. The state S is zero, is that a symmetric or an anti-symmetric state? S is zero. Is that a symmetric or an anti-symmetric state? What? Symmetric state. Symmetric state. Who votes symmetric? Who votes anti-symmetric? Okay, let's look. How does the singlet state look? So singlet. So I have two states. I have electron spin up. And I have an electron spin down. I have to take the linear combination. And it can be symmetric or anti-symmetric. If it's anti-symmetric, so I have two electrons. What do I do here? I have to, So I have plus or minus. Yes. In this case, the M sub S is zero. Yeah? This is M S one, M S two. So I have here M sub S is zero. And I have this with the case that this is a minus sign. Because this is, the projection is zero, I have here a minus sign. There's only one opportunity like this. So this is S is zero. If I have S is one, then I can have the state 1, 1, which is the state, which is this state. I can have -1, which is this state. Or I can have the positive linear combination. So this is, these three are S is one. S is one, M sub S is one, minus one, or zero. And if it's zero, it is 1/2 Are you there? So these are the triplets with the symmetric linear combination, and you have an anti-symmetric state if you have the singlet. Yes? Now I don't dare to ask the question whether I is zero, is symmetric or anti-symmetric. Yeah, now you don't dare to answer, of course, if I ask it like this. So let me simply give the answer. It depends on the total spin. If you have a spin a half, this is the anti-symmetric state. If you have a spin one, if you have a spin one, we have here a nuclear spin one. If I add two nuclear spin ones, it can be two, one, or zero, yes? The symmetric state I get is if I take both parallel. That gives me your symmetric state. So it's a state where I can have I is two. And it oscillates between even and odd. So this is also an even state, a symmetric state. And this is the anti-symmetric state. So it is you have to watch out. And it's very interesting to look at the spin states, if they're more complicated, to sort out whether it's symmetric or anti-symmetric. Okay, so what we have is we have an anti-symmetric electronic spin state, we have a symmetric nuclear spin state, or an anti-symmetric nuclear spin state. We couple them in a molecule, and the molecule or the colliding particle can have angular momentum which is either odd or even, yes? And for the angular motion, the angular motion is described by the YLM, yes? And you know that the even YLMs are symmetric and the odd YLMs are anti-symmetric. Even and odd parity, I should say. Yeah? So what you have here is odd, even, even. So the product of the three is odd, and that's the way it should be for fermions, because we have fermions. If you have this, the nuclear spin state one, then this is anti-symmetric. This is anti-symmetric, and then you also need an anti-symmetric end over end rotation to end up with a fermion. Because if the fermion is in a different angular momentum state, in the end it should be anti-symmetric as we require for fermions. And then, of course, you can also have the triplet states. The triplet states we saw are symmetric. This is symmetric, this is symmetric. And now we have to add to the spin state, we have to add the nuclear spin state. We found out that this is symmetric, and we found out that this is symmetric. Now we have to add the end over end rotation. So to obtain a proper molecule in which you couple two fermions, you need now an odd orbit end over end rotation. So you have odd, even, so the product of the three is again odd, which is a proper fermion, or you have to be here, L is even, and then I can be one and S can be one. Because this is symmetric, this is anti-symmetric, and this is symmetric again. Okay, why did I do this? Because I have to decide when I can have S waves. And S waves means L is zero. There you have an S wave. There you have an S wave. Only molecules that have this symmetry can couple to the S wave channel. Yes? And that means that if I have L is zero, I can have two situations. My nuclear spin can be zero or two, or my nuclear spin can be one, depending on whether I'm dealing with a singlet or with a triplet. Yes? These molecular symmetries, did you see some of it before or never? Who never looked at a molecule? You never looked at a molecule. There's only one honest person in this audience. But you're quite right. We're all physicists. We don't like to look at molecules, is it? But they're there, and in fact, if you start to learn about it, you see it's also beautiful. But let's continue, because otherwise I run out of time. So now I copied this little plot, and so I only copied it, and we have to continue. This is my plot of the hyperfine structure of the atoms, and now I'm going to make the molecules. SA0, you already gave the answer. SA0 is not magnetic, so it doesn't depend on the magnetic field. And so I can plot the SA0 level. It has the energy absolutely not. I don't know what this energy is, but I know that there's an energy in which I have a bound state. So I can use it as a parameter, if you like, in a measurement. And if I have two free atoms, what I have to do is add the contributions of these two atoms. Yeah? So if I have two atoms, I can look at the magnetic field dependence. It's simply the sum of the two. You see, this one goes up, this one goes down at low field. That means if you add the two, you start out horizontal, and then it curves down with twice the slope that you have here, because you have two free atoms like this. So that is the energy of two free atoms as a function of magnetic field. And that's, of course, important, because if we do Feshbach resonances, we come with two free atoms, and we want to couple to a bound state. Yeah? So, and the energy of the two free atoms depends on the magnetic field, because they have Zeeman energy, the atoms. So I have to search where the energy of the two free atoms couples to the energy of the bound state in the molecule. Now here I already have a bound state. So that means that in principle I could have here a resonance, because if these two energies are the same, I could do this coupling. But let's first continue. Let's look at the S1. S1, whereas when you had an S1/2, you had spin up, you had spin down. If you have an S1, you have three possibilities. M/S is +1, 0, or -1. Yeah? That is without the hyperfine interaction. If you switch on the hyperfine interaction, what will happen is that you will open up a gap here by the hyperfine interaction in zero field. There is an internal field, as you can say. And now you see that all the levels of the bound states are addressed by this this field dependence. So there are, if I have no field dependence, because I'm looking at the M/S is zero, that means S1, M/S is zero, then I have the least bound level that I called ε1. Yes. So these are the ε1, which is not field dependent, and here you have the addition of the field contribution if m sub s is not equal to zero. Okay, then you see that if you look at the field dependence of the molecular bound levels, that are these curves that I've drawn here, that the energy is the same if you are, so these are my states. They depend on the quantum number S, M/S, I, M/I. These are identical particles, so I have big I, total spin in M/I. I now have to search for M/F is zero. So now we know that this S is 1, M/S is +1. Yeah. Now let me see. That means already that M/F is zero. So if this is 1, M/I must be -1. Yes. Otherwise, the sum of the two is not zero. And if you have M/I is -1, it must mean that I is 1. Yeah? So this must be a level that is allowed in this state. So I can analyze all these levels in this way, and I cross now these crossings are the point where the energy of the two free atoms is equal to the energies of the bound state. So what I expect is that if I have a magnetic field, if I scan my magnetic field, that at this value of the magnetic field and this value of the magnetic field and this value of the magnetic field, I will observe a resonance, because there I satisfy the resonant condition. The width of the resonance I cannot say, because it depends on the strength of the coupling. But I know that there is this coupling. We found the term in the Hamiltonian. So it's only a matter of additional information, that aside from the location of the resonances, you also find the width. And this simple model that I give you gives you a very nice prescription for the location of the resonances, but not for the width of the resonances. And you already see that if you know this curve, it's very simple to calculate, and we will have a look at these terms also. It's also very simple to calculate. It means that if you can measure, so there's only one unknown. Actually, I should say there's two unknown. We don't know what the energy of the least bound levels is. We don't know what the energy of the least bound level in the singlet and triplet potentials is. But you can use it as a parameter. That means if you do a measurement and you see resonances at these three points, then you know exactly what is the difference between those two energies. It cannot be different. So then you know the difference in those two energies. But that's what we will discuss tomorrow. I first want to show the following. If you do the full calculation, you take your Hamiltonian, you diagonalize the Hamiltonian, then you get this curve. Yeah. And what you see is the character that I described. These are the continuum states. These are the bound states. You see here 1, 1, 1, minus 1, what we already sorted out. Here you see other states 1, 0, 1, 0. That's also an MF is 0 state, because MS is 0 and MI is 0. Here you see the state 0, 0, 2, 0, which is also a state with MF is 0. And this is the 0, 0, 0, 0, 0 state, which is also a state with MF is 0. So those are the only states that you can have in this case. If you have unlike molecules, you already get more resonances that can rapidly become more complicated. Then there's one more thing to show. There you might ask yourself, how do I see the effect of the coupling? And then it turns out that only in this regime you find something that deviates from what I showed before. Here you see that levels are repelling each other. Only around in this region of fields you get coupling. There is the coupling between the singlet and triplet potential relevant for the shift of the levels. The coupling is always there, but the level shifts of the magnetic levels are only taking place in this region. And this will be a nice aspect for the experimentalist, because you know this coupling is difficult to handle. But you see that in order to predict those resonances, you're far away from the coupling. So in many cases, to find the location of the resonances, you don't need to know the coupling even. It's a very strange situation, but that's the way it is in the case of lithium. Okay, so this, we have to know how to diagonalize this. That's what we're going to do tomorrow. Yeah, so this is not what I'm going to show, because time is up. Too complicated. I summarize. We introduce spin in the atoms. We found triplet and singlet potentials. We search for terms coupling the singlet and triplet potentials. We found that part of the hyperfine interaction is singlet-triplet non-conserving. We found that M sub F remains a good quantum number to all levels of our Hamiltonian. We studied the magnetic structure of the pairs, and we know to search where to search for Feshbach resonances. And that completes the lecture for today. Thank you very much. Are there still questions? Give you some time. Don't feel uncomfortable. Yes? Yeah. What? No, but you don't need to. No, because the exchange completely determines the singlet and triplet. There's nothing else. So then, of course, you have the other terms. The other terms can give rise to coupling between the two. And so if there's an effect of a gap opening somewhere, as we saw in this case, it will show up if you start diagonalizing your Hamiltonian. But it doesn't mean that that something happens to the singlet and triplet potential. How to say it? You analyze here the system completely by looking at bound states in singlet and triplet characters. You might ask yourself the question, to what extent are these things allowed? But I tell you that this is extremely accurate and also tested to more rigorous theories. Because because it was so simple, the theoreticians got interested how we were able to predict the resonances so simply. But normally, if you try to do dynamics of scattering, then at large distances, the proper basis is the hyperfine basis. And if you are at short distance, it's a singlet triplet basis, which is the coupler basis. But you know, to diagonalize your Hamiltonian, it doesn't matter in what basis you do it. Yeah, so I restrict myself to saying I choose my singlet triplet basis only for all bound states. I forget about possible coupling to continuum states. And so I expect that this will be a minor perturbation on the whole thing. And then all I have to do is diagonalize, and then by comparing the pair of atoms. I don't know where I was going. I don't know. Here. This is the area where you find the coupling, where you have a gap phenomenon, if you like. Did that answer you a little bit? Okay, thank you. Other questions? Yes?
Do fraction terms like Darwin and the relativistic one change some of the aspects?
The Darwin term, yeah. So the Darwin term and relativistic corrections, that's what we all learn if we solve the hydrogen atom, isn't it? Yes. They give rise to small shifts. They don't split. They don't split your energy levels. Eh? Mm-hmm. So they give rise to very small energy shifts of the order of the fine structure. Fine structure splitting. Okay, then it means that your bound state is at a slightly different position, but it's for all these magnetic states that I use, this is just a common factor. They all have this the same. So in the measurement that you do, it all drops out. So you don't need it to analyze this singlet triplet coupling, because the Darwin term works out the same if you have the singlet or the triplet. Yes?
Yes. Yeah, it just shifts all the...
Yeah, in the atoms. How it works in the molecules, it could be slightly different, but it's not such that it gives rise to... No, I think it factors out in some way. because I factored out all electronic molecular effects, limiting myself to a molecular ground state, electronic ground state. Mm-hmm. So if you include those terms, I think that the energy of the electronic ground state will go up a little bit or less, but it doesn't affect the analysis of the Feshbach resonance. Yes? Other questions? Lunch. Thank you.